Good evening. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the first of three candidate forums brought to you by the City of San Jose in conjunction with the Mercury News, Bay Area News Group, and the Metro newspapers. On-site voter registration in the lobby is provided by the Santa Clara County Registrar of Voters. Tonight's forum has been modeled after a template provided by the nonpartisan League of Women Voters. We thank all these organizations for their contributions and assistance in conducting these forums. Please join me now with a round of applause welcoming our candidates in the order in which they will appear on your ballot, Deb Davis and Helen Chapman. So as they enter, both of our distinguished candidates survived a competitive primary and received the most votes from an original field of eight candidates. Both are similar in many ways. Both are transplants to San Jose. Both are married with two children that are either currently enrolled or have already graduated from San Jose Public Schools. Both are past presidents of their respective neighborhood association. Both have served as city commissioners, rotating in as chair, and both have a dog.
I have two.
We've been corrected, someone has two. And perhaps what is most amazing, the streets named Chapman Street and Davis Street intersect in the Rose Garden. Or, as I like to think of it, in an area that we will now refer to as the Twilight Zone.
Oh my gosh.
Tonight's host is Bellarmine College Prep, which has been in the College Park neighborhood for 80 years. Bellarmine is an all-boys Jesuit school with a long history of civic engagement. Thank you, Bellarmine, for providing this 400-plus seat theater at no cost. All questions for tonight's voter information event have been submitted by various residents of District 6, not interest groups or corporations, and unlike other forums, the questions are not all written by one person. We've received questions from residents of College Park, Corey, Hamilton Place, Midtown, Rose Garden, Shasta-Hanchett, Palm Haven, Pamlar, and Willow Glen. Please note that we are still accepting questions for future forums. Questions may be submitted by the public 24/7 on the District 6 website. On the district website, you will also find the District 6 Voter Transparency Project, where candidates have been asked to provide their viewpoint on over 60 City Council agenda items over the past 11 months. If you'd like a paper copy, there's one at the front of the stage. We flipped a coin to see who would go first. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to respond to each question, and then both candidates will be provided a 1 minute rebuttal opportunity for each question. Candidates, please be sure to keep the timekeepers in your sight as they will signal your time is nearly up or to stop. We ask that no videotaping be done this evening by the audience as the entire event is being filmed and it is unfair to use a snippet of tonight's forum without providing the entire background. The video from tonight's forum will be posted online this week and will air on the Community Access channel. We ask that the audience please refrain from applauding or cheering your candidate tonight during the question and answer period so we may accommodate as many questions as possible. At this time, I would like to introduce our co-moderator for the evening, journalist Ramona Giwarges. Ramona is the San Jose City Hall reporter at the Mercury News. After stints in Eureka, Salinas, Merced, Ramona returned to San Jose to cover local government and politics for her hometown newspaper. Ramona won numerous awards for investigative journalism and is a graduate of San Jose State University. Thank you, Ramona, for volunteering to be here tonight and your contribution to local news coverage. Metro Newspapers will co-moderate the second forum, which will be held in the Presentation High School Theater on September 28 at 6:30 p.m. The third and final forum will be in a different part of the district on October 17th at 6:30, and that venue will be announced soon. Ramona has reviewed the questions submitted by residents of District 6 and has selected which questions will be asked this evening. Questions will be largely asked in their original form. Ramona may have modified or reworded some of the questions for the purposes of clarity and conciseness. Our first question, however, comes from our host. It comes from a representative of Bellarmine. And I think you already know what the question is. What is your position on the California High-Speed Rail Project and its potential impact in District 6, including its proximity to the campus of Bellarmine and College Park neighborhood? Would you go on record as being against an aerial structure and any moves towards eminent domain in this area?
Hi, thank you for having me this evening. And my name is Deb Davis. I have the honor of answering the first question, which we also answered in the primary, and my answer is the same. I am very concerned about eminent domain happening for high-speed rail, and I actually live in a neighborhood south of the Diridon station that needs aerial on that side. However, I know that in the New Hall neighborhood, the College Park area, and in Bellarmine, an aerial alignment is not going to work. So it's really important for City Council to be very aware of what each of the neighborhoods need and work with HSR to deliver both an aerial alignment south of Diridon and an at-grade alignment north of Diridon, not taking any land from Bellarmine, and making high-speed rail work for our city. We are the 10th largest city in America. We're the third largest city in California, and it's really important for us, if high-speed rail is going to come through our city, that we don't impact the neighborhoods in a negative way, that there is only positive that comes out of having high-speed rail in our city. Thank you.
Yes, okay. Sorry. As someone who sat on the Diridon Good Neighbor Committee, high-speed rail was the subject of a great debate between many of the entities, between the Arena Authority, Bellarmine, North Willow Glen, Shasta Hanchett, New Hall, and College Park. And I am, being in support of high-speed rail, I am also very concerned about the alignment. And what we don't know is really what that alignment is going to look like until I believe it's the next meeting in October. What is frustrating is that we had many, many community meetings. We had the Diridon Good Neighbor Committee, and we had community input on that alignment. North Willow Glen stood firm and said, this is where we want it to go. Please stay out of our neighborhood. Don't take Fuller Park. Don't impact our neighborhood. Don't use eminent domain. And what happened is that supposedly the comments are still there. They're accepting the comments, but they haven't decided what they're going to do with the alignment. I think it's frustrating to provide that amount of input for that long and not know if that input was really valid. And so I want to make sure again that high-speed rail doesn't do anything to put more cost to the city of San Jose in terms of infrastructure. If there's park taking, then high-speed rail needs to replace that parkland. If high-speed rail is going to do eminent domain, then they need to make sure that they are taking care of the person's house they are taking, and even more so. So it's going to be a difficult process, and I look forward to see what alignment comes forward in October.
Thank you, and as you know, you also have the opportunity to rebuttal or add on for an additional minute if you choose.
So I'm part of North Willow Glen Neighborhood Association, and my opponent is right. We have been working on this issue since, I think, 5 or 6 years ago. We put in comments, and we were told that our neighborhood was not going to be considered for alignment. And then all of a sudden, high-speed rail comes back after a hiatus, comes back to our neighborhood and says, oh no, everything's back on the table. We're just starting over from scratch. So I think that's something where the city council leaders need to take leadership and need to take ownership of communicating with high-speed rail. Hey, we've already been there. We've already made these decisions. You can't put things back on the table when you've made promises to residents already. So I do think that's a really important point.
Okay, so tonight's first question from a resident comes from Ray on Camino Pablo in the Willow Glen area. And Ray says, San Jose is one of the most expensive places to live in the country, if not the world. Many of us struggle to get by. How will you approach containing tax increases and using what we already pay to get things done? And do you see a way to reduce taxes? Start with Deb.
Actually, you would start with Helen.
Oh, sorry, start with Helen.
Being that this ballot in November, I think, is going to be the largest ballot we've seen, at least in my lifetime, and the number of propositions and tax measures that will be on there is a little bit astounding. You're going to be asked to vote on a lot of tax measures. That being said, San Jose is one of the becoming one of the most expensive cities to live and to work in. I know that because my two sons live with me, and it would be nice to see them move out eventually. But and you know, and the high cost of rent and the high cost of even the rent for small businesses. I've seen several small businesses. You just saw Fontanetti's on the Alameda's closing after 30 years. You know, and he's using the reasoning is that the cost of renting that space has now become too much and too cost prohibitive. So do we want to price everybody out? Is the reasoning yes? Do we need to tax ourselves more in order to bring the cost down? I don't think that's the answer. I think we need to be building more affordable housing. I think we need to be looking at alternative things like probably making secondary units and working on trying to infill where we, you know, where it's appropriate. It's going to be a big issue, and I don't know there's going to be one fix for the entire solution. Thank you.
Helen, we just want to clarify. So what exactly would you do, though, to contain taxes and to reduce taxes? He wants to know how you would reduce taxes.
As a city council member, I don't know if I can reduce taxes. I would like to reduce my own taxes, but I don't believe that that is something within the power that I could use.
I think the most important thing to do to contain our taxes or contain the tax increases and to allow the tax increases that were recently enacted to expire is to spend our money as wisely as possible. So that's the responsibility of the city council. And as a city council member, I will bring my economic and public policy background to bear in making sure that we're spending our money as wisely as possible and looking for alternatives so that we can spend our dollars, so that we can stretch our dollars. That's the way you contain taxes, is by spending the tax money you get as wisely as possible and providing as many services as you can for every dollar that you receive in taxes.
So do you want to rebut to anything that Deb said, Helen?
I'm a longtime homeowner in my area, so you can't own your home and have it almost paid for without being fiscally responsible. So yes, obviously, if there's a tax measure and the council has the oversight of that tax measure, say Measure B, for example, you want to make sure that that money is going to the services that are at that what the voters intend on, and that is what I plan to do.
And you also get an opportunity to rebut anything you want to say?
No.
Okay.
All right. Okay, question number two, well technically three, right, if you count Bell. This is from Velma. Velma lives on Tamarack Avenue. This is in between the Corey neighborhood and the Rose Garden. She asks, what are your plans, if any, to repair our city streets and sidewalks? They are a disgrace. That one, that's
yeah. Yes, can I have the rebut? Yes.
Yes, right.
It's hard to keep track of these things, and even though we've done this four times already. So I'm glad this question got asked. My platform is all about spending our money and focusing our spending on our five core services: our police, our fire, our roads, our parks, and our libraries. We should be spending about $100 million on our road maintenance every single year. And if my figures are correct, my memory is correct, we spent about under $20 million for last fiscal year on road maintenance. This fiscal year, there is going to be about, I think, $35 million spent. If we pass Measure B, which is the VTA tax, we will actually be getting additional dollars in specifically for our neighborhood streets. I think that's really important because it will help us to actually almost double our spending, which still only gets us about two-thirds of the way. I think it's between $60 and $65 million that we'll be able to spend on our road maintenance. But the important point is that we need to focus our spending on our core services: police, fire, roads, parks, and libraries, before we spend on other nice-to-haves. We've promised those as a city. The city has promised those services to us as residents, and we're not delivering. So road maintenance is extremely important, and it's something that we need to do. I think I've heard a lot about our sidewalk maintenance as well, and that's something that I think the city needs to add back. But I think you all probably feel like it's more important for us to have all of our neighborhood streets and all of our city streets to be well-maintained before we add that back in. But I definitely think that should be on the radar of the city council, and there should be a plan for returning to maintaining both our sidewalks as well as our street trees. Thank you.
I hear from residents all the time about how cost prohibitive it is when a street tree is tagged and you have to pay for the cost of removing the street tree, and then you have to pay for the cost of the sidewalk improvement. I've done it myself where we redid ours. We had to put in a tree and we had to redo the sidewalk, and it is expensive. And I remember the days when, you know, the city came out and did the tree trimming themselves. Unfortunately, a series of budget cut has diminished that service. I voted for the sales tax measure that would put money for our roads and for our public safety. So we are now starting to collect that money, and so we can now start to work on improving our streets and replacing some of the really bad streets. I've walked some streets that I thought this street belonged in the county, where because the asphalt really wasn't there. It was down to dirt and rubble. And so that's unacceptable for a city our size, that we should not have paved roads. The other thing is, along with Measure B that you'll be, you know, asked to support this time, is looking at getting more cars off the road so that maybe we aren't utilizing the roads as much, and really work on enhancing our public transportation system. And so that would give some leeway to the roads. But again, we have to put that money where it needs to go, and the infrastructure on our roads is failing, and we haven't paid a lot of attention to it.
And then, of course, you have the opportunity for a rebuttal statement or other comment in 1 minute. Both of you, of course.
I just have one small point. We definitely need to fix our roads, because buses drive on roads, not only cars, but buses and bicycles also go on our city streets. So it's definitely important to prioritize getting our streets fixed and having them be well-maintained, because the vast majority of modes of transportation use those streets.
Okay, so Patricia on Saddle Rack Street in Midtown says, "When my husband and I bought our home 10 years ago, San Jose was a model city with low crime rates, especially near downtown. Now we do not feel safe in our neighborhood. We often see red light runners and speeders. How would you improve road safety in District 6, and do you support red light cameras?"
I think there was already, we intended on doing, we had red light cameras at one point, and I think they were declared illegal, so.
We've never had them, and they are illegal by state law.
Thank you, okay.
And proper term, sorry, is red light running cameras.
Thank you.
For the questioner.
Yes. In terms of public safety, it is, you know, we are in a public safety crisis. We have 825 police officers, down from 1,400 police officers, which we had a few years ago. And that's just not acceptable for a city our size. We have the ballot measure, Measure F, which I support, which is negotiated pension reform that Mayor Liccardo has advanced and got all the 11 bargaining units. So that is something where we can begin to restore the trust in the public safety department, and we can start to move forward and rebuild our police department. It's hard to go after speeding cars if you're going after murderers and you're going after significant crimes. And unfortunately, that's the call of what's happened right now, is that we are having to triage the calls into what's most important. And unfortunately, the speeding cars doesn't rate it. I would hate to see somebody killed on a public street because our police officer is so low. So we do need to work on that. Again, so I would highly encourage you to look at Measure F as it start to rebuild our police force.
Helen, do you have anything you want to say on the red light camera specifically?
No.
Whether you support them, you don't? Nothing?
I think it's worth looking at all kinds of technology to help out our strained police force in the meantime. Yes, I support Measure F, which is the alternative pension reform settlement that will help us not only rebuild our police force, but maintain some savings and help us get out of our future unfunded pension liability problem. However, I think it is important to also use the technologies that are available to us. So I think we need to have an honest discussion about red light cameras. I personally think I personally think it's worth having a discussion. I like the idea, but I know there are some issues with it, and I think that's something that we need to discuss as a city, and it's worth discussing. There are other ways to help maintain safe speeds on city streets. One of the things that's happened on Bird Avenue, for those of you who ever go down that way, is we have these your speed signs. So it says what the speed limit is, and then it says your speed as you're driving past, and it flashes if you're going too many miles per hour over the speed limit. That actually slows down traffic, and many of you who know me know that I am a data nerd, and I know that there are studies that say that actually those your speed signs slow down traffic on a longer term basis than having a police officer sitting and catching speeders and then moving around the city. So it helps those specific streets that have a tendency to have people speeding on them, it helps those streets on a long term basis. And that's a very cost effective solution. So yes, we need more police on our streets. And I think we need to talk about, again, in the meantime, while our police department is stressed and is understaffed, whether we should have other police departments, like the sheriff or California Highway Patrol, help us.
So same clarification for Deb. Do you support the red light running cameras, yes or no?
I like the idea, but I think we need to have a discussion about them as a community.
So yes.
Yes.
So you get a minute.
In terms of augmenting the San Jose Police with the Sheriff's Office, they have the same difficulty that San Jose PD does in terms of retention and hiring officers. And I believe there's a statement from Sheriff Lori Smith that said at this point they weren't acknowledging that proposition at this moment.
So again, I think it's worth having the discussion and seeing if there is a possibility for either Highway Patrol or the Sheriff's Office, not to pick up all the shifts that we have unfilled in patrol, but to pick up a couple, especially in areas that are near where they're already patrolling. For many of you, I was not aware of this until I started running. Actually, in the city of San Jose, we have a number of unincorporated areas that the county that is just county land. So the sheriffs are already patrolling in those areas. So it might just be able to, you know, pick up a few streets a couple times a week or something like that. So I think it's worth having that discussion again in the meantime as we're rebuilding our police force.
So that kind of touched on the next question. Steve on Shasta Avenue asks, do you support supplementing city police with contracted staff from California Highway Patrol or the Santa Clara County Sheriff's Department?
I think I just answered that one, but you know, I would defer to, you know, how the Sheriff's Office is going to work with the city of San Jose at this point.
So yes, you do support it.
I support leaving it in the hands of the, you know, the process between the sheriff's office and the city of San Jose.
Okay, but as an elected leader, would you say that this is a positive move for the city? Would you support moving forward with it?
If the sheriff's office has the resources in order to move forward with the city of San Jose, I would support it. At this time, I don't believe they do.
I think I just spent my rebuttal talking about this. So yes, I do support exploring that option. I think it's really important for us to get as many people out and many officers out on patrol as possible. We know that there is a shortage of police officers, and we also know, I also support, for the record, expanding the duties of community service officers to do daytime patrols in areas where there is property crime, has been a lot of property crime, but not violent crime. These often property crimes such as package thefts and break-ins happen during the day when people are at work. Now, community service officers are not like police officers or sheriff's department deputies. They can't stop a crime in progress, but they can be eyes and ears on the ground, and they can be a deterrent to people even doing that if they know that there's regular patrols. The positive about having community service officers do that work is that they are trained by San Jose PD. So it would be San Jose PD trained community service officers who are doing those daytime patrols. So I think there needs to be a mix of solutions that we put in place and really look at our staffing to be, we need to be creative, we need to be smart about it while we're in the situation that we are.
So you have a chance to rebut. No rebut? Okay. Deb, do you want to take a minute and rebut anything? That's it. Okay.
Okay, great. And just to clarify, the city of San Jose has not asked the county sheriff for a support, so that would come if the council decided to ask. It has to do that first. And the city is not allowed to ask the CHP until it asks the sheriff first, because that's the protocol. So that's where we are on that topic. This one now comes from Bianca Shaw on Plummer Avenue in Willow Glen. San Jose is the 10th largest city in the nation and attracts global visitors for business. However, it lacks identity. I've traveled and met people from around the world, and they ask what San Jose is like, and I find it difficult to answer. What would you do to help attract visitors to promote our community and technology heritage?
I think it's Deb this time.
I think it's Deb this time, right?
Okay. We always get
this. I got the marker.
I think San Jose is a city for families. I love raising my kids here. I think it's a great place for families. We have wonderful neighborhoods. We have very walkable neighborhoods. Where I live in North Willow Glen, we're able to walk to Lincoln Avenue. We're able to walk to the Alameda. We're able to bicycle to downtown and take advantage of when the kids were younger. I have two children. They're now in fifth and sixth grade. When the kids were younger, we went to Children's Discovery Museum on a regular basis. Now they've graduated to the Tech Museum, where we go on a regular basis, and our members. We also frequent the Art Museum. There are so many wonderful things about San Jose, but I really think our identity is in how family-friendly we are. I really think that's where how we should be marketing ourselves to businesses and how we should be marketing ourselves to tourists. If you want to come to San Jose, it's a great place to bring your family. We have many wonderful family-friendly activities and family-friendly neighborhoods, tons of parks all over the place. That's really what our identity is, and that's really how we should be marketing ourselves, both to tourists but also to businesses, because this is where families live. If you want to be a business, a family-friendly business, or as your workers get older and start to have families, you want to locate in San Jose. That way your families can live in, your employees can live and work in the same city. So I think that's the really important thing for us to do, and actually the smart thing for San Jose. We don't need to try to be any other city, because we're a great city for families already.
I've said it many, many times, and I'm going to say it again. We are a city of great neighborhoods. We don't need to reinvent ourselves. Let's take pride in what we know we are. I mean, we've been through the general plan meetings many times. We've been through the visioning process. And I think it comes down to, we have really significant, beautiful neighborhoods that we take pride in. We have the Rose Garden. We have Willow Glen. We have Pamlar. We have Sherman Oaks. We have Corey. And I'm sure I've skipped many, many. But we were known by neighborhoods. When I first moved here, I couldn't believe, you know, the number of neighborhoods that people know by name. And that's wonderful. You know, they all have that significant value to them. You know, the historic homes, the overlay, you know, the street-lined trees. Tree-lined streets. There we go. The other advantage, you know, the other thing we have is we have two really significant opportunities. One is Guadalupe River Park and Gardens, which could be our Grand Central Park. We have a significant opportunity to increase the trail system so that we can walk from North Willow Glen, walk from Shasta-Hanchett, and use the trail system to connect that. And when we have the Diridon train station, which is going to be the culmination of many transportation modes, and which I see as the metropolitan transportation hub for the city of San Jose, in which people will come to instead of leaving from. And this is something that I think we could be proud of, and it takes that work. We don't have great neighborhoods because we sat down and we did nothing. We have great neighborhoods because we've all gotten involved and we've taken care of them, we've put back into them, just like the Alameda and Lincoln Avenue.
Okay. Greg on Lincoln, but actually in the St. Leo's neighborhood. How do you plan to balance the ratio of jobs and housing? And Ramona, you added background. San Jose's current jobs to housing ratio is 0.8 jobs for every employed resident, creating an imbalance. That means us San Jose residents are having to drive out of the city for work. And the city's goal is to be at least 1-to-1. So again, how do you plan to balance the ratio of jobs and housing?
If I could flip a coin and answer this one for all, I mean, I think we could solve a lot of problems, but this has been the city of San Jose's issue for a very long time. I stand firm on industrial commercial land conversions. We know that our neighborhood stood firm when Mel Cottons wanted to sell and turn it into residential, and we wanted to make sure that last piece of Midtown stayed commercial use, and that means a multitude of uses could take place there instead of turning into residential. We see Midtown, and I know we've done it, we had 22 meetings with the Ohlone Towers project, because again, it was making sure that the existing uses there were not all turned to residential, because residential costs the cities in terms of service. We can also be regionally prudent, and we can look at other cities to take a little bit more of their share. Now we have the housing bond that's coming up, Measure A, which is might provide some incentives for the city of Palo Alto, maybe to take on some affordable housing and take their, because right now they've got, I believe it's 3.3 jobs to every one resident in that city. And I can tell you, my husband drives up to 280, using 280, and can tell you what the traffic nightmare is, because the jobs are going out of San Jose instead of into San Jose. So I think there's things that we can do regionally as well as locally, but you know, it's going to be standing firm on some of those policies that really is going to get us there.
So to clarify, taking a stand on conversions, right? So jobs, no more converting jobs land to housing.
Right. I've been very consistent on that, yes.
I think we as a city need to be a little more proactive in attracting businesses to come here, and businesses of all sizes, so not just the Apples and the Googles, but also medium-sized businesses, and removing roadblocks for smaller businesses. And I've been talking about this for 12 months now, as I've been knocking on doors since September 18th of last year. So one of the things that I've been talking about ad nauseum, I think for some of you, is that we need to streamline the planning and permitting processes. San Jose has a terrible reputation for being very unfriendly to businesses who want to locate here. And it starts with the planning and permitting. You don't get anything new done in San Jose without going through the planning and permitting offices. Right now, it is very difficult, time-consuming, and costly to get through these two departments. So my dentist, for example, bought a dilapidated building that he wanted to renovate to expand his dental office. And it took 18 months and $40,000 to get through planning and permitting just to get started. So imagine this as a small business owner. You're paying rent on your current place, you're paying a mortgage on your new place, and there's nothing you can do to get the work started to go until you get the okay from the planning and permitting office. So streamlining those and those offices and bringing those costs down is one way that we can attract businesses. Another thing is to have an organization, public-private partnership, which we currently have for tourism called Team San Jose, to have a similar one called Jobs San Jose, which would be tasked with figuring out what other roadblocks there are to attracting businesses here, and also having a proactive marketing campaign. Again, we are a great city for families, so we're a great place for people to live and work, and that's a great way to attract new businesses as well.
Deb, so where do you stand on the conversion issue that Helen talked about earlier?
For the most part, I don't think we should be doing conversions. We definitely should not be doing wholesale conversions. However, I think in the case of Mel Cottons, if there had been a way to creatively maintain the same number of jobs, but also put some housing on that land, that's something that we should have been able to look at and to do, but that wasn't the offer on the table, so in that particular instance, I did not support that conversion.
So Helen, you get a rebuttal.
You're good.
Just to be clear, every candidate on every single question has the opportunity for 1 minute rebuttal. So it's up to you to seek that if you choose.
Okay.
I know we keep going over it. So.
Okay.
Next question from Steve on Houston and Willow Glen. Homeless people are drifting from Kirtner Avenue onto Lincoln and are rummaging around and illegally entering private property. With the approval of the new homeless housing off of Kirtner Avenue, what's your plans to mitigate such activities and prevent them from expanding? I believe that's Dev.
Yes.
I think all eyes are going to be on the Evans Lane project now that it has been approved as transitional or temporary housing instead of a permanent supportive housing or permanent housing site, which is what I supported. So as we go forward with the temporary housing, I think it's really important for nearby residents to continue to talk to your council member and continue to talk to the rest of the city council about what you're seeing. I think it's important to continue to go to the community meetings about Evans Lane and to make sure that your needs are heard. I know from walking in that area and talking to residents and business owners in that area, it's a very distressed area, and I am very concerned about adding more stress to a stressed area. So I think it's important to keep the pressure on Abode and to make sure that whatever the contract is with Abode, which is the organization that will be providing the services in that Evans Lane project, to keep the pressure on them and to make sure that the contract is very clear about what they need to do with working with their residents to ensure that there is safety in that area as well as in the nearby neighborhoods.
Homelessness, I think, is one of the most talked about issues right now that I hear at the door, which, you know, it's kind of sad that that's where we've become. I had an opportunity to tour 701 Kirtner Avenue, which was the concern at the culmination at the Evans Lane. And I was very surprised at what I saw. It's really not the people living inside. They're just as disadvantaged as the people living outside and in need of services as well. But except that building was designed as student dorms. So really the way that that building was built doesn't really do the people that are living in there now any service. Can you imagine living in a little cramped room without much service? And the common areas are full of sun and there's no shade. And so they're really working on trying to redesign that building to be a little bit more accommodating for the people that live there. What I support is actually a little bit, there's two issues, let's put it this way. There's the Evans Lane transitional housing, and then there's the issue of existing services that need to be held, that need to be over in that area. And so what I'm proposing is a Project Hope, which would be like a one-stop shop to come in if you've got extra, need for public safety. You can have your Department of Transportation person, you can have your fire person, you can have police, code enforcement, and maybe housed in within 701 Kirtner as they're redesigning this building. So that way, because we know there's a high call for services in that area that already pre-existed before the transitional housing came about. And so that's something that we, as a city, we really need to do. I got to talk to Abode when I toured that building, and I was very impressed with the way that they work with the community and the fact that they're reaching over to Cathedral of Faith and they're working on a food program. In fact, one of the people living in that building now helps them out daily with their food. And so I think it's a good partnership, and it is something to make sure. We want to make sure that Abode is a good partner and working alongside and really simultaneously work on both issues.
This one's from Paul. He's in Pamlar, and he lives on Pamlar. So there you go, that's the name of the neighborhood association. Do you support preserving Coyote Valley as it is today, which is agricultural, or do you favor developing Coyote Valley? If so, do you favor jobs or housing? Does the crowd know? okay, I think it's Helen on this
okay.
one.
This is an easy question. I'm in favor of preserving Coyote Valley. Now, yes, is something going to happen eventually? But right now, Coyote Valley and any project that's coming forward you know, would impact existing wildlife corridor that's taking place now, which is between two different mountain ranges. And so I have been very consistent on my messaging that we should not be developing Coyote Valley either for jobs or residents. We need to contain no more urban sprawl. We need to contain the building within the core of San Jose because we don't have the capacity to move services out into Coyote Valley at this time.
Just to clarify, Cisco Systems and Xilinx, which is a semiconductor manufacturer, both own land there. If they came forward with a project, would that be support or deny?
At this point, I would say deny.
Okay. My understanding is there is a portion of Coyote Valley that is designated for commercial development. Is that correct? Yeah. So I do support having commercial development on the portion of Coyote Valley that is designated for commercial development. We had a question a couple of questions back about our jobs to employed residents ratio, and we know that it is, now I always say 84 jobs for every 100 employed residents. Now the number keeps going down, and I hear it's 80 jobs for every 100 employed residents. I don't think it is wise for us to stop a Cisco or a Xilinx, which have been very good partners in San Jose, have been very good employers for many residents in San Jose. I don't think it's a good idea to tell them, no, you can't develop there. I think it would be better to work with them and say, can we figure out a way to maintain the wildlife corridor and still do the development? Part of the problem with containing all of our additional development in our core urban areas is that right now we have a problem with the level of service of the traffic. So that means that our roads are already super congested. We already, probably all of you know that, just having driven in rush hour traffic in the last week or so. It's really terrible, and it's terrible on the city streets, it's terrible on the freeways. And so continuing to develop in the urban core is very difficult right now, given the fact that we have level of service constraints about adding more trips, vehicle trips, to any individual area. So I think it's really important to take the advantage of commercial development where it can happen and where we've already planned for it to happen. So it's already zoned for that. I don't want to take away our open space where it hasn't been designated to be open space.
No rebuttals on either side? Okay. All right, Mike, who lives on Lupton Avenue in Willow Glen, says, I find it to be a glaring conflict of interest for a city council candidate to accept campaign money from city employee labor unions. It would seem that a union-backed council member would be beholden to these unions when sitting across the bargaining table come contract time. What are your views on this obvious conflict of interest?
I think it's
done. Okay. To my knowledge, I haven't received any contributions from any unions. So I don't have that issue. I am concerned about, I think having individual contributions is fine. And I also think the limit of contributions is very small. It's $600. So probably no person is going to be beholden to any one group by having a $600 contribution. However, what it does tell you is whether or not the person in union negotiations already is maybe more predisposed to one side or the other. So what I can tell you is that if I'm part of any negotiations, I want to look for a win-win solution. I want there to be a solution that everybody around the table can agree to, but that is really great for residents. That's the important thing. So I think it's very important when you're going into negotiations not to go into them thinking you're going to butt heads, but to go into them thinking we're going to find a solution that can work for everybody. And that's really the tack that I would take in any kind of negotiations that I would be part of. So I think that's the important point to remember, is that if you have a collaborative style and You're not beholden to any one group. I'm beholden to the residents of District 6 and the residents of San Jose to find a solution that works best for them, but that makes also the employees around the table satisfied because they're the ones ultimately providing the services that the residents will be receiving.
But just to clarify, so even though you didn't accept any contributions from unions, I think the question is more along the lines of, do you think that candidates should be allowed to accept these type of contributions? In other words, should they deny them?
Well, that's a good question. I haven't ever thought about it that way, but I think that corporations and unions should be treated the same. So if corporations can be making contributions, then unions should be able to make contributions as well. And they're all subject to the same limits.
So yes, I have accepted contributions from unions because I belong to a union. I worked for San Jose Unified for 16 years, and I was part of ASME. And I would say the same thing. If you were going to accept a contribution from a large developer, you know, you want to make sure that you're not beholden to that developer again if a contract comes up and somebody's pushing a project forward. You want to make sure that, again, you are looking at the project in itself, not because you're beholden to the person that gave you the campaign contribution. My special interest in representing City Council is you, the neighborhoods, the community. And that's what I've done for 25 years. You know, if somebody comes in and says, I gave you money, I'm going to look at it through the lens of how is this going to benefit the community, not necessarily the person that gave me a campaign contribution, because then that's what matters. And you want to make sure that negotiations are done in good faith, because we don't want to get ourselves in a way where we've backed up people against the wall and we've created difficulties in the past. So again, I would be very clear. My representation is you, the community, first.
Does anyone want to rebut?
No.
Either side.
See?
All right. Chris on Calaveras in the Rose Garden neighborhood says, as the Chapman campaign has made an issue of Davis's Republican Party background, I'd like to know how the candidates actually voted in the previous District 6 elections in 2006 and 2012, and Chris also wants to know who you voted for mayor in 2014. So D6 elections 2006 and 2012, and then mayor in 2014.
Boo, boo, boo.
Don't answer,
that's not good.
That's ridiculous.
I tend to agree with the audience.
Okay, so both candidates declined to answer.
I always vote for the most fiscally conservative candidate in local races, but I will say that I didn't vote in the 2006 race for District 6 because I did not live in District 6 at that time.
Okay, so yeah. Megan on...
So we have Megan on Hanchett Avenue in Shasta-Hanchett. Each of you are affiliated with a different political party, Democrat and Republican. Please discuss your political ideology and how that ideology and your political affiliation will influence your priorities and decisions on a local level.
That one's Deb first.
Deb, can you repeat the first part of the question?
Each of you are affiliated with different political parties, Democrat and Republican. Please discuss your political ideology and how that ideology and your political affiliation will influence your priorities and decisions on a local level.
So I'm the Republican of the two of us, if the previous question didn't make that clear. And what that means to me is that I'm fiscally conservative. I am a more socially inclusive Republican, so everything you read about the Republicans in Congress who get the most press and who talk the loudest and who do the most shouting on Fox News, I don't identify with them. I identify with more of the Bay Area type Republicans, like Catherine Baker, who is, again, fiscally conservative and more socially inclusive. So Just a small, short personal story, for example, my family and I were on vacation in 2015 in the summer when the decision came from the Supreme Court about marriage equality, and I remember exactly where we were. I was in the car and we were stopped at a gas station. My husband was filling gas and he was checking his phone while he was doing that, which I know he shouldn't do. But he opened the door and he told me what the decision was. And then my kids wanted to know why I had started crying, because I was just so happy that some of my friends would now have the ability to get married when they couldn't before. So that's what it means to me to, that's kind of what my ideology is. That's what it means to me to be socially inclusive. And in terms of fiscal responsibility, I mean, those of you who know anything about my campaign, you know what I'm gonna say. I am all about focusing our spending on our five core services: police, fire, roads, parks, and libraries. I think it's important for the city to provide the services that it has promised to provide to its residents. And that's the kind of thing that I'll be focused on in the city council, is more the fiscal issues, because that's in the purview of city council. And I don't think the social issues really are within the purview of the city council. So that's what it means to me, and that's how it will influence what I do on the council.
Okay, so she's the Republican, I would be the Democrat. And I'm proud to be a Democrat. My father was a Democrat. And my sister a Republican. So I guess, you know, but I look at city council, it really is a nonpartisan race, and this really shouldn't be Republican versus Democrat, though, you know, people would like it to be. It's about doing the job, and it's about serving the people to the best of your ability. And it's about working on those solutions. We've got some very difficult things to deal with right now. We have homeless. We have affordability of San Jose. We have a public transportation system that we need to work on. We have crumbling roads. We have a public safety department that needs to be rebuilt. Do we want to get involved in partisan politics? No. I want to get involved in solutions that help the community. I mean, that's, again, I said, you are my special interest. You are who I'm working for. I've been doing this for 25 years. I've been in service, my family's been doing service for the community for that length of time. You know, and that's what the job is about. Do I share Democratic core values? Yes. But I bring my sense of experience to the job, and that's what I'm going to provide to you, the citizen. Thank you.
Sorry, I ran out of time. But what else I wanted to say was that I have been endorsed by both sides, people from both sides of the aisle. If you saw the video on my Facebook page, Mayor Liccardo and former Mayor Reed, as well as Vice Mayor Herrera and Councilmember John Camas, have all endorsed me, and they spoke up for me last week at City Hall, outside of City Hall, at a press conference that I held. So I already know that I can work with people on City Council, and the mayors have faith that I can work across the aisle and be collaborative, and they know that I have that collaborative style and that data-driven style, so that we can continue to push smart policies and to continue to make our city an even better city for our families.
Anything else?
No.
Okay, Cecile on Emory in Rose Garden wants to know, what is the level of education you have received, and what was your major? How will this degree help you make decisions for the 10th largest city in the U.S.?
Well, okay, I have an associate degree in merchandising from the Fashion Institute, so I don't really, again, I'm gonna go back on my experience, and that's what is gonna bring me to do the job for you as city council member, not my merchandising degree. You know, it's the work that I have spent in the community. It's building building Hester Park near the Rose Garden Library, which took 4 years, and you have to work with a developer, you have to work with the school district, and you have to work with the city of San Jose, and you have to reach that consensus, and you have to go back and forth. And you're not gonna agree on things when you first begin the project, but when you get to the end of the project and you realize you've done something and you've given back to children of many generations now, you know, you know you've given back something significant. Working on the Alameda project and bringing that grant in that, you know, from then Assembly's Jim Bell, that brought $4 million in relinquishment money.
You know, that was work within the city of San Jose, and again, you had to bring in those entities. You had to bring in the property owners and the business owners and the three neighborhood associations, and you had to work with people across the aisle. And yes, you know, having the degree is wonderful, but it's the experience that you bring to the job and the knowing the people that you have those relationships with that's going to keep you going when you have to face those tough issues.
My undergraduate degree was in economics, and I received two master's degrees recently from Stanford University. One of them was in public policy, and the other was in education, policy, organization, and leadership studies. So I feel very well prepared from that perspective of having a very good basis for evaluating policy alternatives. So something that Stanford does, prides itself on, is being very, instead of being theoretical and very ivory tower, being very practical and having projects instead of theses that are, you know, something that nobody's gonna read. So a couple of the projects that I did while I was at Stanford actually were part of the policies that were happening or being discussed in San Jose at the time. So one of them was about the Lincoln Avenue Road Diet, which I'm not expecting a question about that this evening, but I have done actually two studies on Lincoln Avenue Road Diet. First, I did a cost-benefit analysis study with some colleagues at Stanford, and then I did an update when we got some additional information, which, by the way, were part of our recommendations from our first study. So that was one issue that I worked on, and then the other issue with another group was on community service officers and really looking at how community service officers programs in other police departments all throughout California, how those are structured, how community service officers are utilized. And what we got from that were a few great recommendations, again, about expanding duties for community service officers, because our program is only 2 years old. And for those of you who don't know, CSOs are administrative. They don't carry a firearm, but they have some training and they're able to do some paperwork here in San Jose. In other cities, they have expanded duties, and I'd be happy to talk about that, but I have just now run out of time.
Let's see here. This one is from Doris. Doris actually doesn't live in District 6. She lives in District 1, but she submitted a question, but she actually, I know this person, they volunteer at the Rose Garden. And the question is, very pertinent question, considering District 6 has four of them. How do you think the city should handle mobile home parks that are destined for closure?
It's yours, right?
Yep.
I think this is a really tough issue. And I'm glad that we're continuing, the city council is continuing to talk about this. So there are a couple of, as I understand it, the economics of a mobile home park have been changing over the last few years, 40 years, however long. And so there is one proposal on the table that I think will continue to be discussed, and it's called an opt-in proposal. So for in exchange for continuing to stay open, residents agree to provide additional funds so that the park can be maintained in a better way. I think that's a really creative idea, and I think that it's really important for San Jose to entertain these creative ideas. There are some mobile home parks that are in areas where we have already slated for high density development, and mobile home parks are, by their very design, a not very dense development. So I think we need to balance the needs of the residents, and if we are displacing residents, we need to provide compensation for them. We need to provide an alternative for them that is holds them harmless. I think the best way to say it. So I think that mobile home park closures need to be dealt with very very deliberately and very intelligently to be creative, so that we can find a win-win solution to the tenants' needs and concerns, but also the property owners and their property rights and their concerns for their own families and their own financial well-being.
I know, I want you to,
I don't support the opt-in policy. I went to several of the meetings. The average person in the room that lives in a mobile home park is probably over 55 years old. These are retired seniors, and this is their, you know, this is where they live. And we might be pushing out one leg of our affordable housing, which is our mobile home parks. These are people that have paid their dues. They've worked here, they've lived here, and they're retiring in a mobile home park, and now they're scared. They don't know where they're gonna go to. And are we gonna displace more people? We've displaced 600 people, in the Winchester Ranch project, and really with not much of a guarantee on what housing they're gonna go into. We have an affordable housing crisis. You know that San Jose is a very high cost place to live in. And so if we're gonna reduce our tools and our mobile home parks and our affordable housing units, then where do people go? Do they move out of San Jose because they can't afford to live here anymore? You wanna be able to, if you retired here and you've got family here, you wanna be able to stay here with your grandchildren. You wanna see them grow up. You don't wanna have to move somewhere else because you can't afford to live here anymore. And I don't feel that that's what makes San Jose great. I was at a wedding not too long ago, and I heard about the displacement in Vancouver, Canada. That's embarrassing for a city this size, that we're talking about displacing 600 people, and it's migrated, and that policy has migrated up to Canada. We've got to do better as a city, where we've got to be ensuring that we're giving everybody, the tools they need to be able to stay here. And mobile homes are one of them.
So the hundreds of people that my opponent was referring to, that was not a mobile home park. I just want to be clear. There is a different proposal on the table for the mobile home park that is nearby the Winchester Reserve Apartments. And my understanding about that proposal is that the mobile home park owner has heard the residents' concerns, that they don't want to move out of that area, that they want to stay in that area. And he has made what I think is a very fair offer to build in the first phase of development, to build on that same land condominiums for those residents to be able to move into and to keep their same rent, which they pay, I believe it's about $800 a month, to keep their same rent for as long as they live, as long as they desire to stay there. And I think that's a really fair thing to do. So it keeps people in their home, on the site, in that area. It keeps people from having to move multiple times. And there can be similar creative solutions for other mobile home parks.
Okay, any rebuttals?
No, okay. I stand for my
don't support the policy.
And just to clarify, it is the Reserve Apartments that will be closing. There are 212 units, and it's an estimated 600 people that will be displaced. But also Winchester Ranch Mobile Home Park is slated for closure in about 2 years. It's unclear how many folks would be displaced during that. That's for redevelopment.
I know they're two different projects that just happen to be very close in proximity.
Yes, and we do have one follow-up for that particular question. So obviously the city cannot stop a mobile home park owner or property landowner from closing the park or selling his land. But what can the city do to encourage the mobile home park owners to stay in business, especially since this is some of our last affordable housing stock? What can the city do to encourage them to stay in business?
That's my question. Okay, I'm going back and forth here.
I think you need to sit down and talk with the residents. I think, I've talked to several of the mobile home park owners, and I think they are working on some possible solutions that might be outside of the opt-in policy. And I think it's worth listening to what they have to say and what they want to bring to the table. They're aware of, what the needs are and what's being addressed right now. But I don't think they were very much in favor of the opt-in policy because it wasn't something that they came up with themselves, and it was something that feels that they're passing through the expenses of the property owner onto themselves, and I don't think any of us would want that to the homeowner ourselves either. So I think it's worth really sitting down with them and pursuing more options. Right now, I think opt-in seems to be the option that seems to be considered. I think there's other things that can be looked at.
I think it's important to have all the stakeholders at the table in the discussions when you're trying to determine the best outcome and the best policy. Again, my background is in economic research, and I have negotiated a number of data access agreements, many of you have heard me say this many times, with state education departments. And what I learned from that process is that you have to go into your negotiations with a win-win mentality. There can be a solution that it's not going to make everybody jump for joy, but there's going to be a solution that everybody can live with. And I think that's where the city needs to take leadership and say, we're going to have everybody around the table. We're not going to meet separately with residents and separately with owners. We're going to have everybody around the table so we can have a true dialogue. And the city's role is to be impartial in that dialogue and to be a facilitator of that dialogue and to make sure that it happens so that we can get to the best solution for the most people.
Okay. So staying on this topic, and this is going to be something that the council is going to talk about in 2017, should the city council pass a relocation ordinance, meaning whatever property you're in, if the private property owner and you're renting decides to knock it down and build something else and you're displaced, should that property owner pay you? And how much should that be approximately, if you have any ideas? And again, this will be coming in 2017 to the council. I can't remember.
So I'm not sure that we need to have an ordinance. I don't think having a specific dollar amount is the way to go. My background's in economics, so what we know is that when a property owner is choosing to do something else with their property, there can be, let me get nerdy, negative external effects, right? And so I think it's important to have those negotiations and to consider the displacement, because we do have a shortage of housing in our city, in our county, and in the whole 9-county Bay Area region. So I do think it's important to have relocation benefits, to basically have basically a sharing of whatever the property owner's profit is going to be from changing that use of their land. However, I don't think it makes sense for policymakers to sit down and choose a specific dollar amount, because we know from our business tax that was passed in 1986 that we don't get around to changing those rates very often. And so it doesn't make sense for us with our very volatile market that goes up, and it also goes down occasionally, believe it or not. We haven't had that for a while. But to have a specific dollar amount put into policy that we know we're not going to be responsive enough to change. So I think the policy should be more about what the process is for residents and property owners to sit down and negotiate what that dollar amount should be in each individual case.
I'm very process oriented. And being in the community for a long time, you go to a lot of meetings and you learn from having that dialogue and having everybody at the table at the same time. This is one of those discussions that I think deems a very good process, making sure that it's open, that you invite all the stakeholders, because again, this may be something that the property owners are going to have a differing opinion than the mobile home park owners, or even affordable housing owner, or residential owner. I would have no idea what to set that dollar amount at this point. I think it's worthy of that discussion. I would like to see, I would assume this is the housing department that's going to lead this discussion, that how they deal with those meetings and invite the stakeholders in and have that discussion to see what kind of compromises bubble up to the top. At this point, I have no position.
And just for the discussion, there have been amounts suggested, because you have to start somewhere. So some people have suggested paying X thousands of dollars or month's rent or something to provide that. But that hasn't been discussed at the council yet, but it's coming, it'll be coming in 2017. This question is from Bob. Bob's on Houston Avenue, again in Willow Glen. Will you support keeping the Los Lagos golf course open? And Ramona's notes are background. City is paying $2 million a year from its general fund to subsidize the golf courses. Los Lagos has 18 holes and has been seeing a 28% drop in play And then the council has considered closing the golf course and reusing the land. Please, someone remember.
Okay, thank you.
Los Lagos, this came before me when I was on the Park Commission, if I do recall. Whether or not Los Lagos retains itself as a golf course, I would like to see that as used as park space, because that area is park deficient, and whatever uses continued should be open space or recreation for the existing neighborhoods. I would not want to see that property sold off for housing.
We currently have three golf courses, or 2.5 if we're being precise about our numbers, and for our city. That's city-owned golf courses, city-run golf courses. And I think, I don't know the actual percent of decline, but for all golfing as a sport, golfing is in decline as a sport, and soccer is definitely in having large increases over time. So I think it's important for us to evaluate not one individual golf course, because I think we need to hear from golfers about which of the three golf courses they prefer and why. And we want to keep open probably only one golf course and let the other land be used for park space that could be utilized by many more residents. So again, I think it's important to get input from all of the stakeholders and the golfers in this case. I've heard a lot of them who really like Los Lagos and really don't like Muni. So I think it's important to, and some of you, I heard a little whisper, so maybe some of you really like Muni. But what I've heard at the door is more Los Lagos golfers than anybody else, that they like that course, and they think the Muni course is not as interesting. So I think it's important to evaluate all the courses and then decide which one we want to keep open based on which one is going to have the most use.
And just for the record, the third course that was not mentioned is Rancho, which is a nine-hole golf course on District 5.
Okay, so since we have some additional time,
since people didn't rebut as much.
No one rebutted. Councilman Oliverio has said that we're going to be able to ask you guys about some of the measures that are coming up on the November ballot. So we're going to start with opportunity to work. And for folks that may not know, this measure, if it's approved in November, would basically require businesses to offer additional hours to part-time employees before they go out and hire additional workers. It would basically ask them to offer those hours to the existing workers before they go out, with the idea being that those part-time employees could increase their hours and their pay. So I guess we could start with Deb.
Either one.
Deb, do you support opportunity to work? Yes or no, and why?
I do not support Measure E, and I think it is misnamed. We have already said San Jose has only 80 to 84 business jobs for every 100 employees. So we know that it's hard for San Jose to attract businesses. If we continue to pile on the regulations, it's going to continue to be harder and harder to get businesses to locate here and to get businesses to stay here over time, especially when they can go to Santa Clara, they can go to Campbell, they can go to Sunnyvale, they can go to Milpitas. They're very nearby, and they don't have the other cities don't have those kinds of regulations. Also, I think it's really important to note that businesses were not at the table in the discussions when Measure E was being drafted. So there was no input from a very large stakeholder in that measure. So the feedback that we've received from businesses is that they're concerned about the paperwork, the record keeping that they would have to do to report on all of these issues. They're concerned about the litigation costs that are sure to come over disputes on this issue. And we also know that it's likely to cause extra bureaucracy in the city of San Jose. So that means it's going to cost us as taxpayers money to administer this new program or requirement if it in fact gets passed on the ballot. All of this means that there will be fewer jobs in San Jose, not more. And what that does is it makes it less likely for entry-level or entry-level workers, especially our youth, to get a part-time job after school. And we know that if you can't get to that first rung on the ladder, you can't climb the ladder. So I am opposed to Measure E because I think it's going to continue to discourage businesses to come to and remain in San Jose.
And I support Measure E because, again, it is opportunity to work, and it doesn't necessarily apply to all businesses, as I believe it's businesses with 39 employees or more. Give or take.
35.
Thank you. 35, 39. So, you know, this wouldn't be every business. And again, you want to make sure that you're offering the existing employees time that if they need that extra hours and they want to work more, that you know, give that opportunity to them rather than bring in another employee. Because again, you want that institutional memory. You want that person that's going to give back to their job. Because then again, when you're providing good service to your job, you're providing good customer service to the person receiving it. And so I do support Measure E.
I think it's important to note that there are no exemptions for event-based or temporary businesses, so we are going to see our Spirit Halloween stores popping up over the next couple of weeks, if they haven't already. I haven't been out and noticed any. And there are no exemptions for those types of seasonal businesses. In addition, I think it's also important to note that there are no restrictions now on offering your part-time employees to keep your institutional knowledge, to provide better customer service, to offer your part-time employees full-time employment. We want these kinds of decisions to be made where they're best made, which is at each individual business. I believe that business owners want the best for their customers and their employees, and they're making the best decisions possible to keep their businesses open and thriving. And putting a regulation on them that isn't right for them doesn't make any sense.
I would add that you're worried about the businesses, but you won't need to worry about the person that's trying to work two or three jobs just to pay the rent. And I think we have to consider that as well. And so there's extra hours, and you want to get that person to invest and live here in San Jose, then we have to be able to make sure that they can grow within the company and they get those extra hours and not bring another person along. So you're spending more time going from job to job trying to make ends meet.
Measure C. What's that?
Okay, so I'll do Measure G. Okay. So Measure G is the business tax modernization. And what this would do, if approved in November, is it would increase the business tax, which hasn't been modified in 30 years. So businesses are paying the same amount for the last 30 years. And this particular measure would increase that revenue that I believe is about $12 million a year. It would basically double that revenue, which would be general fund dollars,
right? Mm-hmm.
Which could be used for any city services. So do you support Measure G, yes or no, and why?
I do support Measure G. I think it's time that we overhaul the business tax and try and bring some more money into the city of San Jose instead of placing the burden on the residents. So, you know, we've been paying a significant amount of sales tax for some time, and I think it's time to share the cost.
So this may surprise some of you because I've been talking about how hard it is to do business in San Jose. However, I do think it is time for us to modernize the business tax. So I am supporting Measure G. And part of the reason that I'm supporting it is that businesses were at the table when this measure was drafted, and they said, this is what we can live with. We want to be good citizens of San Jose as well and give our fair share, and this is what we can do. So I think it's really important to note that all the stakeholders were at the table in this discussion, and that's why I'm supporting it. The great thing about this measure is that there are many great things about this measure, by the way. It puts a cap on the increases over time, so it caps them at the rate of inflation, but a low rate of inflation, so that businesses can know what this expense is going to be over the lifetime of their business. They will have this as a known expense and a known increase over time. That's great. The second thing is that for small business owners who are a low-income household, it caps that tax for them as well. So we're really looking at increasing the tax revenue without being a burden on our businesses, and with giving them the certainty that we're not going to continue to change the tax maybe every 30 years, but we're not going to continue to mess around with this and tinker it with it, because we've built in very measured increases over time that follow the rate of inflation. So that's why I'm supporting Measure G.
Read it or you can read it. So the last one is Measure F. It's the pension reform modification. I already know the answer, but we're going to ask it anyway because the audience may not know. So how do you feel about the pension reform modification and why? Ramon, do you want more background than that? Or is that satisfactory?
Yeah. Really?
Okay, great. Thank you.
So this is Measure F, and I am supporting it, and I'll tell you the process I went through. I supported our pension reform Measure B back in, I think it was 2012, and I supported V&W before that because we were in dire straits at that time, and we were in danger of having to shut down very many of our city services just to pay for our pensions and our pension liability. Our unfunded pension liability was getting out of hand. It is still very large, by the way. But I am supporting Measure F because I sat down with the Office of Employee Relations, one of the people there who's been through all of the negotiations since, I think before 2010, and we sat down and we looked at it. I like to look at things analytically. So I went through the provisions of Measure B. I went through the litigations of Measure B, so it kind of became Swiss cheese after we voted on it. And then we went through the provisions of Measure F. And there are some new provisions in there that weren't, you know, that weren't in Measure B. So I am supporting it because we have, all of the unions have agreed to it, so we know it's not gonna get litigated, or there's a very, very small chance that it would get litigated. That's great. We are dealing with any future unfunded pension liabilities and have agreed to share those costs between the employees and the employer, which is the city, which is all of us. And also, it puts in place, it deals with the healthcare costs, which are a ballooning cost over time, and something that we didn't necessarily consider in the measure in 2012. And finally, it puts it into a statute that we as voters have to have the say if there are any future pension benefit increases, even if they're retroactive. So it puts the power in the hands of the voters going forward to know that this is our agreement going forward, and anything else has to be discussed in the light of day.
I think I stated earlier that I support Measure F because, again, it is negotiated pension reform that I'm glad our mayor was able to get consensus from all 11 bargaining units in order to do that. And it's something we need in order to move forward. And it puts back in some certainty around the disability clause that was removed with Measure B, which I think was some of the reasons why some of the police officers were naturally upset about it. So I am in support of Measure F, and I do urge everyone else to support as well.
So congratulations, you've reached the end of the questions, and now is time for your close. We want to thank you both for all your hard work that you've done so far in the campaign. You're both winners at this point. You beat six other people, and you know you've put your family and friends through a lot. But now is the time for you to give your best in the last 90 seconds. And I believe we flipped the coin, so then Helen, you're first.
Okay, great. Stand up. Hello. I'm thrilled to be here today, you know, and at debate number 5 and a series of debates we have going forward. So probably by the end of the part, you're going to know everything there is to know about me. But one thing I want you to take away is that I've been a part of your community for over 25 years, and my husband's been a part of your community, and along with my sons. Brandon did the Rose Garden Markers in the Rose Garden as part of his Eagle Scout project. My husband ran the website for Shasta Hanshew Park Neighborhood Association. I've worked on projects alongside of you for many, many years, and I've named a few of them in the debate today. I got started because there was a street light out on my street, and the ambulance went by my neighbor's house because they couldn't find the house. I went to my first council meeting, and I got that street light. I requested that from Councilmember then Nancy Ioni. So I have been actively working in my community to make it better since Councilmember Nancy Ioni, who I'm grateful to have her support.
I'm grateful to have your support as well. This is a long campaign. We've been walking, knocking on doors for quite some time. And again, I look forward to sharing more stories as we continue the debates. But most of all, I want to work hard for you on day one because we have some significant issues to work on. And you are the best, you are the constituent that I want to serve the most. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming tonight, and thank you, Ramona and Councilmember, for moderating. My name is Deb Davis, and I hope to be your next council member representing you for District 6. I am pleased to be supported by our former Mayor Reed, our current Mayor Licardo, as well as our Vice Mayor Rose Herrera, and our current one of our council members, Johnny Camus. And the reason that I have their support, the reason that they have endorsed me, is because they know that I have a collaborative style and I have a very data-driven style. I want to include everybody, have stakeholders at the table, and include all of that information when I make a decision. So I really appreciate having that opportunity. I've been knocking on doors for 12 months now and have heard from many of you, and I think that you're looking for that kind of a style. I have the basis in research and the basis in public policy training to be ready on day one, to listen to your concerns and to find best practices from other cities, either in California or outside of California, and to evaluate the options for San Jose to determine what is best for us. So I really appreciate your support and I look forward to working together over the next 4 years. Thank you.
Let's give another applause to both our candidates. So thank you to the studio audience, since this is going to be on Create TV. Thank you, Ramona, for volunteering tonight and doing all the work that you did. And again, we want to thank and congratulate the candidates and thank Bellarmine for donating the space. And the next forum, again, will be at September 28th, 6:30 at Presentation High School at the theater. Thank you very much. Have a good evening.